All right, so I'm Ann Alton, the physical therapist here at Illinois Regional Pain Institute. Most everybody knows, but I think you're new, so that's... Anyway, today we're going to be talking about kind of the neuroscience of pain and how we learn and all kinds of kind of what we think we know now compared to what we knew, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, and what most of us grew up being taught about how pain works. That said, it's going to end up being probably two classes at least, and this is a repeat from about a year, maybe a year and a half ago, but it's going to be another class because I got some stuff in the mail this week and I haven't had a chance to look over it yet about some new therapies that are available for this sort of thing. So the first one I got was neurofeedback, which is using EEG technology. Hey, look who's got to make an entrance.
Should we stand up and applaud?
You need to start like,
do
like
the wave.
110. Start like 110.
Deep plod would probably be better.
Huh?
Deep plod instead of A plod.
Right, right. So the first one is the neurofeedback, where they're using EEG technology to help you to retrain your brain waves. And it's supposed to be good for things like ADHD, autism, traumatic brain injury, post-concussion syndromes, post-traumatic stress, addiction, as well as pain. So anyway, that one I'm looking into. The area that does it here, or that I know for sure, it's pretty much cash only. They accept credit cards, but it's a cash upfront program. It's not cheap. That said, I'm still looking into it just because I think I've had a lot of concussions in my life and a lot of brain injuries. So I'm also kind of thinking in terms of maybe some of this isn't set off by the fact that I can't think straight. So some days are worse than others. But anyway, so that's one thing that I wanted to kind of bring up next time. I'll do a little bit more research and reading into it and kind of talk a little bit more about that. The other one that I got, this is me completely geeking out. I got this book. It's all about different like ways to use your brain and learning to actually work with your chronic pain condition, okay? I learned about this book through reading another book called The Brain's Way of Healing. And that one is by Norman Doidge, MD, and he does a whole lot of, like, the first chapter is on chronic pain, okay? The next chapters are on things like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's and some other things, the stroke and just different things like that. But so this was the first chapter. He talked a lot about this guy, Michael Moskowitz, who had chronic pain. He's a chronic pain doctor. He's a psychiatrist, and he had chronic pain for like 13 years, I think, from a neck injury, water skiing accident. And he started learning about pain and reading like everything that he possibly could lay his hands on new neuroscience of pain. And what he learned was basically some of what we'll go over today, but I want to go over some other of his techniques because he's developed more. Anyway, so he basically cured himself of his chronic pain condition. And he said, really, I don't want to talk about managing pain anymore. I want to talk about curing it. Yeah. So this book was not cheap. Okay, it was $50, I think, by the time you add in shipping. If I like it well enough, we can look at there. You can buy like a crate of them, and for like $30 a piece. So we can look at doing that. But at any rate, that's just something that, you know, it's a workbook. There is supplemental material online that they keep updating, and you know, so there's interactive things, there's videos and stuff that you can watch, so you're engaging all of your senses, which studies show is really much more important in terms of your ability to learn and retain, is to engage all of your senses. So there's supplemental material online too. So in the next month or so, I'm going to be working through this a little bit for myself even. But anyway, yeah. So already, like, first two pages, I've already had some, like, holy cow moments. So anyway, I'm really super excited about that, and everybody who knows me knows that I got really pretty easily on.
It sounds really interesting.
Stuff. Yeah, I'm kind of excited about it. And so next class we'll kind of go over, you know, through some of the basics of that, and you know, some of the other options that are available in the area, for kind of getting into the brain and kind of how do we change it. So anyway, so today we're talking about the neuroscience of how pain works, and kind of the major issue is the difference between what acute pain is and what it means and what chronic pain is, and how it, we don't know how it becomes chronic or why. We just know that it does, but what the difference is then between those two things and how you change your attack in terms of treating it. So pain, basically, first off, I need to define the word nociception. Okay, nociception is a fancy term for information that comes from the body about potentially dangerous stimulus. Okay, so heat, excessive cold, chemicals, blunt force, sharp, those kinds of stimulus to the body activate those nerve fibers, the nociceptive nerve fibers, to take them to the brain, okay? And the reason why I'm defining that is because there is a difference between nociception and pain, okay? Because you can have nociception without pain, all right? Anybody ever gotten undressed one night and saw a humongous, brand new, huge purple bruise on your leg and said, where in the heck did that come from?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was, you had nociception there. Those nerves got fired. Obviously they did, because there was some tissue damage there. But it wasn't painful. Okay? And we'll get into a little bit of how, why not in a little bit. But you can also have pain without nociception. Okay? And my typical example of that is your kind of your paper cut. Okay, there's not a whole lot of tissue damage there, but dang, does that thing hurt.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's one of the worst, yeah.
Right? And so, I mean, it's just, and there's also, there's a story, really great book called Painful Yarns. There's a story about a girl who had an ant crawling around in her ear. And for a while, it was just kind of an odd sensation, and she kind of complained to her parents about it, and couldn't, you know, she didn't know that it was in her ear, really. It was just kind of in that, you know, and then after a while, she started complaining of a headache, and after a while, it became excruciating, and they took her to the doctor. They couldn't figure out what was wrong, and in the middle of the night, they took her to the ER, and they looked in her ear, and sure enough, there's this little ant, okay, playing around in her ear. And, like, I just want to, you know, but just even thinking about it.
Yeah.
But they washed it out, and the pain went away. Well, the ant wasn't doing any damage. There was no real nociception there, other than there was, but so she had pain. But the body was trying to signal her, there's something you need to pay attention to. There's something amiss here, and we need to deal with it. Okay, so that's essentially the issue of nociception is just the information that comes from the body about whatever situation, whatever stimulus you have, okay? So another example of pain without nociception is your phantom limb pain. You've heard of people who lose their leg but they still have foot pain. Mm-hmm. That's a big one. There's obviously no nociception coming from the foot because there is no foot, but yet there's still pain. So our old understanding of how pain works was there's tissue damage, which is pain, and you fix the tissue damage and the pain goes away, right? Well, that's kind of how we all grew up learning about how this works, and actually that doesn't make any sense at all, and everybody who's sitting here knows this, because if it's this, I'm gonna bet dollars to donuts that at least you've had at least one doctor look at you and say, I don't know what to tell you, you're healed.
Don't know what else I can do for you.
Right, don't know what else I can do for you, because you're healed, and you're like, but but I'm not. I feel, you know, I feel horrible. So that's at the point where it kind of becomes from acute pain to chronic pain, okay? And we're not quite sure what happens, but chronic pain has a lot of times less to do with what we call issues in the tissues. There is still usually some issues in the tissues, but it has less to do with that and more to do with changes in the nervous system over time. Okay. So acute pain, the purpose is to alert you to injury, help guide your behavior, and aid your healing. Okay.
You want a drink?
Alright. So like for example, if you break your arm, okay, that hurts really bad. Okay, that motivates you to go to the doctor. It motivates you to go to the ER, get an x-ray, figure out what's wrong, put a cast on it, okay. After a while, that pain, initial pain, kind of starts to subside a little bit. But then you also have this pain that continues, and part of that is the inflammation. Inflammation in and of itself is kind of painful, and the purpose for that I think of in terms of, you know, like a construction zone. Those are your flaggers. Those are the guys who are saying, hey, slow down. Don't do too much too soon. Okay? So that inflammation is there to keep you from re-injuring the arm before it has a chance to heal. Okay? So just it's always there kind of reminding you, hey, you know, be careful with me. Be careful with me. Okay? So, but basically you have, when you first break your arm, you have this initial firing of the nerves in your arm, right? But you also have information from the environment. You have your situation. Oh, I fell down some stairs. Okay, so your brain takes that into consideration with this pain in the arm. You look down and you see it's kind of a little bit malformed and you're like, okay, that's not right. Okay, so that information also gets taken into consideration. There's also, so all of that gets put together in a assessment of how dangerous is this injury really, okay? And we have a protect by pain line that will often spike up before we know for sure if it's a really dangerous situation. So if you, I used to do this all the time as a kid, I'd be running through a field and I would twist my ankle. And I would go down and be like, ow, 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 ow. And then kind of, oh, I guess it's okay. You walk it off, and all your friends are going, you know, you drama queen. And it's like, well, no, but it really hurt. So I hit the pain, protect by pain line, didn't get into tissue damage yet. Okay, so there is that. It doesn't have to be necessarily tissue damage in order for there to be that pain assessment. But we also need to include things about how much do I need my arm to do my work, or to take care of my kids, or to my daily life. Okay, how important is that? So if you can think in terms of two different scenarios. One is a guy who plays the violin for a living, gets a bee sting on the tip of his finger. Okay. Ow, that's going to impact his living much more than a twisted ankle would. But the security guard who walks all night, twists his ankle, that's probably going to bother him more than a bee sting on the tip of his finger, right? So your brain does take all this stuff into consideration before it makes its assessment. The thing about it is it's lightning quick. So I don't know if you guys have seen too many optical illusions or not, but here's one, for example, okay? This one, these two lines right here, the horizontal lines, are they the same size? Is one longer or is one shorter?
One longer, one shorter.
Same.
They are the same size.
They are?
They are. No, they don't look like it, do they? Okay, but from the ones that are saying that they're the same size have probably seen this before and are now looking a little bit more closely at the ends of the lines. they're an even, right? Mm-hmm. So they're kind of looking a little, okay, we know that this, my brain's been tricked by this before, and so we're going to look at this a little bit more closely. Okay. But the thing about it is, you look at it, initially, when you look at it, you say, well, the top line's longer. Of course. Right? And that's because our brain has to take into account 3D. So when we see we see almost like railroad tracks here, right?
Yeah.
Okay? And so our brain understands that as things go further into the distance, things look smaller. So we have this illusion here where things look like they're getting smaller with the vertical-ish lines. They look like they're getting smaller. So we know this should be smaller in order to be the same length as the bottom, right? Only we don't think all of that through. Our brain goes like that and says, all right, so this is without conscious thought, okay? So that one's a really good one. The next good one that I like is this one. This one makes my eyes cross. Are these lines straight or not? Are they parallel?
Twisted game of checkers.
It is a twisted game. They're like kind of LSD or something. Like,
yeah. It's lined. Horizontal lines are straight.
Okay. What about the other lines?
The vertical lines are straight, but they're just not all pointing the same way.
So all the lines are straight.
I know there's a trick.
And all the lines are straight, and all the lines are parallel. Okay. So they're all right angles.
Huh.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If you look at it closely enough, and I can pass it around if you want me to look, you know, if you look at it closely enough, you will see, but your brain does not want to do it. Like, you can see it and then it's gone, and you see it and it's gone. Because your brain has to make really snap judgments about what the world is. Otherwise, you're spending a ton of brain power figuring out just how to use a chair. Yeah. Right? Okay, so we have to, as we learn, and as children learn, like if you ever have seen, they used to do some horrible experiments with children, where they would do this glass floor, and then they would put like a step underneath it and make it look like there was a drop off.
Oh.
And then they would put toddlers and children and crawlers in there to see if they would stop at this visual drop off, even though they could crawl straight out, it was perfectly safe. Okay, so this kind of thing is a learned thing, all right? But these snap judgments, they keep our brains from having to do a ton of work, make sense of our world in a really, really quick way so that we don't have to spend a whole lot of brain power, real estate, trying to figure out the things in our world that are pretty consistent, okay? Anybody want another one, or are we done with the optical illusions? We're good. All right. If you want to see it, you can see it later. It's a good one.
That is a good one.
Isn't that one? I'm just, I mean, it crosses my eyes every time.
When you get up close, now you see what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you do. You do.
And if you look at the back, it's very obvious. Because I was looking at the back.
Very good. Very good. All right, so we have this acute pain, all right, that is basically trying to guide your behavior and make sure that you are behaving yourself while your body is trying to heal. Okay. The next thing that happens is that some of us, the nervous system and the body doesn't quite calm down the way it does in other people or it has in previous injuries. And we don't actually know exactly why. Okay, but at some point, the brain has decided that this is a very dangerous situation, and what you're doing about it just really isn't good enough. Okay, and it's or you keep doing too much, or you're doing, you know, and so I have an instructor on a lot of this neuroscience of pain. Great guy named Bob Johnson, works up in the Chicago area. He's a physical therapist. And he says, you know, I just tell my patients, your brain is loving you too much. It's trying to keep you from doing too much too soon, but doesn't understand that you're actually, there's not anything real ominous happening. Your bone is not broken anymore. okay? But it wants, it's loving you too much. It's trying to hold you back. It's trying to make sure that you stay safe. Because the last time you twisted your back, you're out of work for 3 years, or you had to go on disability, or you couldn't, you know, take care of yourself, and you had to have somebody come in and help you with you know, your bathing and all of that stuff. So, you know, your brain is remembering what happened before, as well as what just happened. Did I fall down the stairs? How did I do this thing right now? Okay.
I experienced that firsthand.
Yeah? Okay.
We talked about that.
Yeah, go ahead and tell your story.
Go to work on something, or I haven't go out to the garage. I need to charge my lawnmower blade for a long time. And I'm sitting there one day, and I'm like, I'm going to go do that. And the closer I got to my garage, the heavier my body got. I couldn't walk. And I was just stopped dead in my tracks. And my lawnmower blade did get sharp for a couple of years. I mean, or to work on anything, yeah. You know, to do anything around
your
the house. It was like I become allergic to tools. You know, I would get stopped dead in my tracks. Eventually, I mean, it took a long time, over a year, but eventually I got there.
Yeah.
Just this past year.
Yeah. I mean, and it just is, it's one of those things where it's like your brain knows, like, gosh,
I couldn't understand it.
The last time.
I can't make it past the refrigerator to get to the garage door. It was the weirdest feeling you ever want to experience.
I've started to trick myself. I've started, like, you got to trick yourself to keep, you're like, oh, just go look at something. You're not there for any reason. Go into the room or do whatever, you know, if you have, like, the stuff to pick up. You're like, just go in there, Amy. You don't have to do anything. You can walk in there, walk right back out. But I know once I walk into the room, I'll, like, pick up one thing. And I know I'll kind of, you got to trick yourself.
Your brain processes everything that you're going to do to whatever it is that you're going to do. And it says that's too much, and it stops my ability. In a nanosecond, I already know. Got to hunt down the tools. Got to take the long, turn it upside down, take the blade off, do the blah 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 blah,
right.
Sharpen it, and put it back together. And I'm like, yeah, that ain't happening.
It's running that calculation.
Exactly. That's
how it
goes.
No way.
Yeah.
All right. So chronic pain. We're all familiar with it because we've experienced. I also like to call it persistent pain. Honestly, trying to change my verbiage on that, primarily because I've had people come in and say, I don't have chronic pain. I'm like, well, but you've had pain for 2 years. Well, I don't want to have chronic pain because that means I'm going to have it for the rest of my life, right? So I'm trying to change that verbiage to myself about, it's persistent, okay? It's persistent pain. So, persistent pain problems, we call that as lasting any more than 3 months. And that's the arbitrary number that we've given for the what it should take your body's tissues to heal. Okay? Typically, we call that 6 to 8 weeks, but we are giving it an extra month to make sure that the pain has a chance to subside. After that, if you still have pain and your doc has said, well, really, your back is better, you know, after that, that's when you kind of say, okay, then we have an issue, not just maybe with the tissues, but also with the fact that my brain has learned that the next thing or this thing that I'm going to do or about to do or am doing is going to cause problems. Okay. Basically, there are a couple of different things that happen, and I included this in your packet today. This is a huge packet. I just got all, like, handout happy today. I've given you this handout before, but this is, like, how their nervous system changes with chronic pain. So the nerve endings will actually put up more alarms, will put up more sensors for those alarms, so it's easier to set them off, okay? Your spinal cord will actually kind of amp up the reception of anything that comes from that area, okay? I think of it like a middle manager in the department that's in trouble in a large company, okay? That middle manager is like, he's got his ear out for anything that could signal trouble, and he's wanting to make sure that he gets reports from the people on the floor every day, or in every hour, or however often, because this department is in trouble, okay? And then the brain changes, because I think of the brain as the CEO of the same corporation. The CEO is he's monitoring that department a little bit closer, okay? Here I have a list of 10 areas of the brain, and they've identified 19 areas of the brain that are associated with a pain experience, okay? And actually, that's any kind of sensory experience. But I've listed off 10 here, and then I gave you a picture of a brain so that you could kind of see all the different places in your brain that the experience goes in order for you to process it, okay? So we have where it goes to the sensory cortex. Well, that makes sense. It goes to the sensory area of your brain to map out where is this happening in my body, okay? It goes to your memory. Gosh, have we done this before? You know, what was the result? Well, we've bumped into this table a billion times. This is not a real big deal. So that's when you get undressed at night and you have that big purple bruise, because your brain says, oh, that, you know what, we do that all the time. It's not a big deal, okay? Right? It goes to your prefrontal cortex with problem solving. So if you do need to do something about this, you can, you know, so you fell down the stairs. Okay, how am I going to get up, back up the stairs and get up? Or how am I going to, can I reach my cell phone so that I can give somebody a call? Whatever. Okay. Cingulate cortex. Well, this makes sense. This is all about your concentration and your attention. All right. You have pain, you got your concentration, your attention right there, right? Okay. The amygdala, which is emotion and motivation. All right. So, you know, that kind of makes sense too, right? Your motivation, if you're in pain, you need motivation, right? The motor and premotor cortex, this is how am I going to move differently now that my arm doesn't work right? Or now that my back isn't functioning the way, or I mean, now that every time I try to turn this way or that way, my back starts to squawk at me, how am I going to move differently now? Okay. And then it also goes to the cerebellum, because that has to coordinate all of those new movements. Your visual and your auditory cortex are also involved, because it has to determine what is the situation and what are some possible ways that we can get up and go to get help or reach the cell phone or whatever it is that we need to do, okay? So what I learned from this new book that I got all geeky about earlier is a couple of things. Number one is that the brain will check in to the body 30 times every second of your life, okay? Now, obviously, we're not doing that this is not your thinking part of your conscious part of your brain. but it's constantly monitoring. Where am I now? Am I got too much pressure on this one sit bone? Do I need to shift my weight? You know, what's going on? What's happening? Where are my arms? Am I gonna head for right? Okay. So it does this, so that just tells you all of this is just really not in a conscious manner, okay? The second thing that I learned is that when we have an acute pain experience, all of these areas, they light up under an MRI, and a functional MRI. They can see that there's activity in all of these areas. I said, and actually there's 19 of them. However, only about 5% of the neurons in those areas are actually firing. Okay? When we have a chronic pain experience, we do the functional MRI, 15 to 25% of those neurons are firing. Okay? So things that get fired get wired. Things that get used constantly will be easier to use next time. Okay? And this is you may think that some of this is a really complex thing to learn, but I don't know about you, but I use this all the time, but have you ever meant to stop off at the grocery store on the way home from somewhere that you go every day, and then you get drive into your driveway and you're like,
I go,
oops, crap.
I did that yesterday.
Oops. Yes. I missed it. Well, the entire drive home has been shortcutted in your brain. You know it. You don't have to think about it anymore. Okay?
Many years ago, I got to the intersection, and I used to commute from Peoria to our farm. And I got to an intersection in Pekin, and I went to the store and I bought antifreeze. And I got home and I looked at my husband and I said, did you ask me to buy antifreeze? Yeah. I had no memory of the conversation. But it was there, and I went.
Exactly. I mean, so what happens is, you know, these kinds of things happen on a regular basis and are wonderful, beautiful plastic meaning that it can change. Brain takes care of it for us. So we don't have to. We just have to look out for what's different. Okay? So if you've ever had the experience where you've driven home and you don't remember driving home, and you're like, oh my gosh, that is really scary.
How did I get here?
Well, in reality, what happened was nothing unusual happened. Nobody tried to pull out in front of you and made you go, oh, wow, I'm driving home, right? Nobody, you know, nothing really unusual happened. And so your brain just kind of took care of all the extra details, which is a really nice thing. Because otherwise, like I said before, we'd be trying to figure out how to use a chair every time we got it. So, you know, we got introduced to one.
Amy, would that be, would that be true about also sometimes I get up and I can't remember that I have pain?
Yes.
You know, it's just like
so this could be a good thing too.
It could yes.
be a good thing, but it could be a scary thing because I'm thinking, you know, I just can't remember.
Right.
I feel like I'm okay.
Yes.
Until I get up and start moving around and then I kind of remember.
Yeah.
I do have some problems here.
Yeah, pain amnesia is actually, that's a really good thing. We want to use that as much as we can. So at any rate, that's turns out that when you practice something over and over and over again, and another really good metaphor that I read the other day, and actually I think it was in this great book that I got, was about learning how to read. Okay, so when you first start learning how to read, somebody has to show you this very bizarre shaped pointed thing with the line across it and tell you that's an A and tell you that that can sound like ah or a or right? Okay, so somebody has to tell you that over and over and over and over again. And how many times do you have to practice your ABCs before you learn them? And if you're me, you never learn them. So, I mean, but, you know, it's, so then you, so very small steps, right? So the next thing you do is you start taking those sounds and you start sounding out words. And then you start sounding out whole sentences. And then all of a sudden, like, magic happens where you can read. And you're looking at these black marks on white paper. And you're vividly hallucinating. You're seeing things that you have never seen before. You're imagining things that you have never... You're thinking about doing things that you have never done before. And you're hallucinating. You're there. Okay? So that all started with a very small, very, very small, hard step. Okay? So when we talk about how do we deal with pain from this neurological standpoint... Keep that in mind, that things don't get learned overnight, okay? It takes a long time for us to learn and really get these things deeply embedded in our system and in our body and in our brain. So initially, the brain, we get this information coming from our body about a certain movement or a certain pressure or a certain temperature, something like that. We get this information, comes from our body, goes to the spinal cord sends it up to the brain, and the brain can say one of three things. The brain can say, okay, spinal cord, this is about right, we should take care of this, we should do this. You know, everything is kosher, right? The brain can also say, yeah, you know what, spinal cord, I know a whole lot more than you. All right, we have done this before. We have bumped into this particular table, you know, every day for the last 10 years. This is not a big deal. We don't need to pay any attention to this until you get undressed that night and you got this great big bruise. So At any rate, so, okay. And then the last thing I can say is, thank you, spinal cord, but I know way more than you do. This is a really big deal. Because the last time this happened, we nearly died, or we had to quit work, or we had to go on disability, or our quality of life for the last 15 years has been atrocious. We haven't been able to see our friends, and we've lost all of our friends, and don't go out and do anything anymore, and we're a bump on a log, and we hate our life, and we don't see why we're here on this planet. So this is a big deal, right? Okay. The good news is that the brain can learn that. It can also learn, hey, you know what, guys, this really isn't a big deal. We know what this is. This is spinal stenosis. It's not going to kill us. It's all right. Okay. So there's a bunch of different ways, and this is what I propose that I go over next time, is kind of how to do this. Functional MRI shows that just the very act of looking at a picture and saying, is that a right foot or a left foot? Or if you've got back pain, is that somebody turning to the right or left? Or turning to the, I don't know my rights and my lefts either. Tilting one way or another, and having to do that kind of that math in your head actually lights up the same areas of the brain that are associated with actually moving that body part. So in a sense, we have pain in that body part. We're lighting up 15%, 25% of the neurons that are associated with that body part in our brain. We look at a picture, is this person turning right or left, or is this a right or left body part? Okay. We're forcing that area of our brain to compete for real estate. Okay? And we're also firing off those neurons without then also firing off the associated pain experience, which we would do by moving or using our back or using that foot. Okay?
I don't want to wait a month for this.
I know, cool, huh? Okay, so I did not give you in your packet the right handout, but that's okay. The graded exposure is another handout that I gave you in regards to one of the ways that you can kind of train your brain with this. And this graded exposure is in landscape. It's kind of about we have this protect by pain line, right, that our body has that may or may not include tissue damage. We twist our ankle, we go ow, 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 and kind of move it around and it's fine, okay? That's that protect by pain line. Well, when you're in pain 100% of the time, that protect by pain line doesn't work anymore because it's always on, right? Mm-hmm. So our body makes another line, and we call that the flare-up line, okay? And that's when you go grocery shopping and you pay for it for the next 3 days. Right?
So you do after this.
You do too much at once, and then you're going to pay for it for a couple of days. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this graded exposure is, okay, how many people have experience with children? Okay. So if you have a kid that throws temper tantrums, and you want to get them to stop throwing a temper tantrum for a sucker, okay. Yeah, no. You ignore the temper tantrum, right? Okay. All right. But what happens if you wait 5 minutes in and you're like, okay, that's enough. I'm going to give you the stupid thing that you want. Okay. Now the child has learned 5 minutes of temper tantruming is the bare minimum that it needs. Right? Okay. And say you've taught this child that 15 minutes is the bare minimum. Okay, and that's kind of what I think of as my back.
All right. That's a good idea. That muscles with kids.
They're temper tantruming. Fix. But we're gonna try to get through this without setting off the temper tantrum to begin with. Okay. All right. And so we're gonna try to figure out with this graded exposure to activity. We're gonna try to find out. So the flare up is the temper tantrum going over 15 minutes. Okay, so we're gonna try to work in the zone of under the flare-up line, but probably you're still going to be in a little bit of pain. I need to work on that analogy. It's not quite working the way I want it to work. But anyway. Anyway, so the idea is we want to work underneath that flare-up line. So we need to find out what can you do. So you need to sit down. This is really depressing. Okay? I'm going to warn you ahead of time. This is a really, really depressing exercise. You need to sit down and figure out what can you do in a day without tipping over that flare-up line. Okay? What can you do in a week without tipping over that flare-up line? Okay? And you're going to do that every day. Or thereabouts. You can have a little bit of variability in there. That's a good thing to build in variability. But you're going to do that every day. So if it's, I can walk 2 minutes without ticking off the back, then you're going to walk 2 minutes every day. And it should be something, this should be something that is hard to do on a bad day, but doable without flaring up, but it's hard, but easy on a good day.
Okay. Isn't this the risk and reward?
Yes.
Thing that we've talked about before?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah. So you're going to just kind of do that, fly under that radar, under that flare-up line, until it gets a little easier on a bad day.
Right.
Then you're going to bump it up just a little bit and resist the urge to go, well, I can do 2 minutes, I can do five. Resist okay, that urge. So you're going to go up nice and slow. You're going to go up real easy. Okay, what can I do? What kind of think I can
Baby
do?
Steps.
Baby steps.
Baby steps.
Okay. And so all this time, you're retraining the brain that walking isn't dangerous anymore. Okay? Because we're not getting over that flare-up line. You see what I'm saying? So that's one way you can get through this. Okay? Turns out, there's like so many more ways.
She really likes that.
Book. I'm so excited.
I look forward to hearing what you've learned, what you're going to teach us.
Yes, I'm so excited. Anyway, so that's one way, okay? The other way that this guy did it was a lot of the areas of the brain that are lit up during this whole experience are associated with visualization skills, okay? He happened to be very good at visualization. So he took a picture of a brain that was in a functional MRI that had a chronic pain, which is a lot different, let me see if I can find it real quick, is a lot different than one that's in acute pain.
Wait, what was that one that's in?
Acute pain. So it's one that, you know, say you just broke your leg.
Okay.
Okay, so this is the acute pain experience. This is the chronic pain experience. So you can see it's much more lit up with a chronic pain experience. Okay. But anyway, he took a picture of this, and he imagined this was his brain, and he imagined these little dots shrinking to where it was a pain. It looked like a brain in the MRI without any pain at all. Okay. He said he did this every time he had pain in his neck for over a month. Okay? And he said that basically...
Like every little time?
Every little time he imagined this. Okay? Of course, he got very good at imagining this whole thing happening.
He had to, like, sit back in a quiet room and actually...
When he does this, when he does this now, he asks people to do it like 7 times a day, I think.
Okay.
But this was a program that he was developing for himself, and so this is what he did with it. And he said, you know, the first week, I thought, maybe this is working a little, you know, maybe a little. The second week, he said, gosh, you know, after having constant pain for the last 13 years, I've got like 2 minutes. Today, we didn't have any pain at all. Okay, and the third week was a little bit more, and by the fourth week, he really started to see some gains. Okay, so the moral of the story is it does not happen right away. It is, again, like learning how to read. You got to start really, really small baby steps, and you're not going to see that magic happen for a while. Okay, now the visualization isn't the only way. He recognized that after he got through this, that not everybody made good at the visualization stuff. So he was like, there are other ways to get into your brain. And so he's developed this whole workbook of different ways to get into your brain and to start that retraining process. But doing the visualization, and I think personally, from what I understand about how all this works, it's not necessarily what he envisioned, the idea of this, that these bright areas of the brain were lighting up and not lighting up anymore. It's not necessarily that he was visualizing that, but that he was visualizing himself, A, getting healthier, which studies show that the attitude and the belief in being able to become healthy again is really important. But the other thing was is it's forcing hope is really important. And the whole idea also is that he was forcing the areas of the brain that are associated with visualization, forcing his pain experience to compete for real estate with this other hopeful thought. Does that make some sense? So he's interrupting the whole loop of all these different areas in the brain lighting up and talking and cross-talking with one another. He's interrupting that with attention. And remember, that was another area of the brain that got us lit up, was the attention area and concentration areas and the visualization areas, forcing those to compete with the pain experience, getting them to reroute and using those for other things, okay? And so was talking with a patient earlier today about how distraction actually kind of does work.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? And it's not that you're ignoring your pain, because that we all know that doesn't work. But if you can get yourself into something that's really, really cool, then you kind of forget, and that's because you're forcing your brain then, you only have so much real estate in your brain, and you're forcing those activities to be what your brain does instead of this other old pain song program that's been stuck in your head for a while, okay? All right. Now, at this point, I start to think, well, crap, it's that easy. Don't you think I would have done that a while ago? But it's not that easy, okay? It's like learning to read. Learning to read was not an easy thing to do, and there are a lot of people who tried and tried and tried and still don't do it very well because it is a very difficult, very brain-intensive activity. So is this.
Practice.
Okay. So keep that in mind. I'm not saying, oh, just go home and visualize. You'll be fine. You'll be fine. It's no problem. Alrighty. Oh, God, love you. Thank you. I keep dropping. See, you know, your water was not the only thing. I've fallen off stools today. I have almost walked into windows today.
Really?
Doors.
The paper thing is becoming a running gag, though.
Yes, it kind of is.
It kind of is.
Alrighty. So there are a couple of other ways to do with the imagery. The graded exposure. Pacing. I want to say something about pacing, and this is kind of the same thing that's about the graded exposure. Pacing is to kind of just make sure that you're not flaring up, making sure that you're not, you know, doing, like, on a good day, I'm going to get my whole house clean today because I can do it today, okay?
That's what I do, yeah. And it's
that pacing is trying to avoid doing that. I have another person that I have seen recently who loves to walk, absolutely loves to walk, and she was doing, I don't know, 30 or 40 miles every day, and then she stopped because it was killing her.
30 or 40 miles?
Yes.
Who has time for that?
I know, who has time for that? But
I can do two.
But no, not every day, every week. I'm sorry, I don't know what
still,
I said. The 30, 40 miles every week. That's a little more better, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, there's my word-finding problem again. Anyway, so she was doing that, and then she quit altogether, and then, of course, she was miserable. Because then, I mean, that was killing her. So then she decided she was going to start back up again and went with 5 miles, and that killed her. She hadn't done it in like, a month. Okay. So pacing is this whole idea of let's not try to, you know, build Rome in a day, okay? And that, in working with people with chronic pain, I've noticed that we're not lazy people. We feel lazy right now because we can't do as much as we think we should. Because we ignored our body when it was whispering and saying, hey, slow down. We put ourselves down on the priority list, we put ourselves last on the priority list, and didn't deal with it And now our body is loving us so much, it's saying, no, you've got to stop. Okay? So pacing is the idea of drawing yourself back from this whole, I want to go, 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 do, 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 do. Oh my God, I just said do, do.
I get stuck because, like, you haven't, I haven't had, like, it's, I only have energy, like, once every 2 weeks. So then I feel like, oh, I have energy today.
I better
get it.
Yeah. But what would happen? But what would happen if you did some every day, and then the day that you had energy, you just kind of enjoyed having energy instead of trying to get your whole house cleaned. Would you maybe have some spoons? Would you maybe have some spoons left over and have energy 2 days in a row?
I don't.
Or maybe once every week. Maybe those days would come more frequently because you're not completely running out.
Blow yourself out on one day.
Right. Okay. So pacing is not trying to calibrate your whole world around not having a flare up. Okay. Another example is the patient that came in and said, "Oh, I went fishing the other day. It was really a lot of fun, and I was helping with the anchor, and I woke up in the middle of the night and my arms were killing me. I'm not going to do that anymore." And I'm like, what?
You fish, let somebody else pull the anchor.
Well, number one, let somebody else pull the anchor. But for right now, does it mean that you can never do that again? To me, I had this visual of her standing on a volcano, throwing in fishing, in with all the other lovely, fun life activities that she's giving up to this god of pain. Because her body said, no, that was too much. Okay, well, then goes that then. Maybe that will shut up.
Her brain is like kind of...
Joe versus the volcano. You throw in the virgin and maybe the volcano won't explode, right? Well, we know that doesn't work.
On the good days, you try to do more because you're so happy.
Right.
Yeah, you're like, oh, I feel good. Like, hey.
Yeah. Yeah. So the pacing is two sides. Mm-hmm. Okay. You don't throw away the stuff you enjoy doing. Maybe back it off a little bit or start training for if you want to be able to do that. You want to be able to walk those 5 miles. Okay, great. But you don't start with 5 miles. You start with walking down the block. Okay, or maybe, you know, if you're, depending on what kind of fitness your body's in, you may do a half a mile. Okay, but you don't start with the marathon. You start with the small baby steps. Right. Okay, so that's the one half of the pacing. The other half of the pacing is don't overdo it on the good days. Okay? Makes some sense.
Hard. But don't you
it is
have
hard,
to?
It's hard.
You have to kind of overdo it a little bit every day in order to gain?
Well.
Even when you're
okay,
praying,
so,
it's like, could stop, but you know what? I did. This is where I stopped yesterday. So I got to push just a little further.
A couple of things on that, but very good question. So we're talking about the protect by pain line versus the flare up line where you pay for it for days. Okay. And for us, if we're going to try to move this flare up line and get rid of it completely, we're going to have to work over top of that protect by pain line. So we're going to be in pain whether or not with what we're doing, we're just trying to keep from crossing over, and unfortunately it's an invisible line and it moves, so some days you could do something and it won't bother you at all, and the next day it'll kick you over to flare up. So I mean, sometimes it can move, you know, and if you're getting a cold, that really drops that line, but you know, things like so all of that stuff really does play in, so you kind of have to do a little bit more. Although I will say not every single day, okay? You're going to, one of the things that I noticed with, I used to be very active and very athletic as a kid, and I could do, you know, strength training workouts every single day. It didn't bother me. My body recovered, it was fine. You know, after I got my diagnosis of fibromyalgia and I started to get better and I started to do things and I started to work on, my big thing was push-ups. I want to be able to do a good push-up. So I started doing push-ups every day. And pretty soon I got to the point where I couldn't do anything at all with my arms. Okay? And I think that the issue was, so I was going backwards.
Right.
Okay? And I think that it was because I was not giving myself enough recovery time. because I have a chronic issue, my body is working really, really hard at everything that it does. So it doesn't have enough resources left over to just fix it. Okay, so I learned that if I do push-ups or arm training 3 times a week, tops, I'm good. But I can't do it at the same level 3 times a week. I have to do 1 hard day and then 2 medium days. Or, you know, 2 semi-hard days and then 1 really super easy day, or skip it. Okay, so it depends. I mean, I really have to give my body a whole lot more time. And once I figured that out, now I can do 50 push-ups. But it took, my gosh, it took me probably 3 years to figure out, and you can't do this every day. Yeah.
So listen to your body. That's not easy to do. It's your will.
Hard.
There's always your will, mm-hmm. and then there's your body, and they create it.
And you have to go at the speed that your nervous system is going and not the speed you want to go. Yes, it is.
That's going to be like a lot of paying attention.
It's a lot of paying attention, and it's one of those things that we're not very good at, because we're typically people with chronic pain are typically people who are going and going and doing things, and not, we're taking care of everybody else first. Mm-hmm. Okay? So that's something that's really hard. Learning how to dial it back is really difficult.
Okay, so if you kind of figure that schedule out, that you're going to do, let's say, a lot 2 days, and then medium for 2 days, or a day after, and whatever. Do you need to compensate with something else? Like, you know, like runners say, okay, big run coming up, I'm going to do a carbohydrate load the day before, or I'm going to eat, I don't know, protein or whatever they eat afterwards, or
yes.
Do you have to do that?
Somewhat, yes.
And how do you figure out what that is?
That's a good question. You should come to my nutrition class that I hit last.
Mom's here.
I know you were. That's a very good question, and the answer to that is yes, you have to support your body in this training. Okay.
So you
and I call it training, even though we're just off the counter.
At least make you think that you're replenishing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you make sure. Am I getting enough sleep so that my body can heal while it's sleeping? Am I getting enough nutrition so that it has the building blocks that it needs to repair? And am I getting enough, you know, hydration so that things are moving well in my body and that they're not, you know, dehydrated. I mean, all of these things are really, really important to pay attention to. And so, yeah, in terms of training, if we're going to use that metaphor, and I really do like it for, even if we're just getting from couch to a normal lifestyle, you do have to support the body in order to get that done in other ways as well. It's not just the getting off the couch. It's also making sure that you're eating right, that your medications are appropriate for you, that all of this stuff that you're talking with your doctors about how this is happening and anything else that's happening, because most of us have not just a chronic pain issue, but we also have, you know, GI symptoms, and we have, you know, heart issues, and we also have all this other stuff. And so that is, you know, important to make sure that everybody's on board with that. And so that is your question.
Well, just take it easy. You're getting older. But if you're that patient that went from zero, just quit, and now you're trying to get back up to somewhere.
Where you were.
Okay.
Even if you say, well, I can't get to where I was 2 years ago, but I'm going to try for 90%.
Right. Good. So there's a couple things I have to say about that. Number one is it absolutely drives me bad. Crazy. When somebody blames age. Okay, that correlation is always going to be there, because you know what? Time always marches on. But I've met 20-year-olds who are, you know, their bodies are like 80-year-olds. And I've met 80 and 90-year-old people that are going faster. They're running circles around 17-year-olds. So I don't quite buy into that whole thing. Yes, there are some changes that happen in our bodies as we age. Mm-hmm. then we kind of have to accommodate that. But that happens when you're two as well. You're going through a growth spurt. You're going to eat twice as much as you did last week. Those kinds of things are always happening in our bodies. We always kind of have to adjust for that. So age is not a contraindication for anything ever. Period. End of sentence. Okay. I have
that's people a snap judgment thing too in your brain. That's
like, yeah. I'm older.
I'm a year older.
We do have that culture where we expect for people to slow down as they get older. I don't want to. I don't want to. So at any rate, so that's what I have to say about the age thing. Whatever. Age is a number. Okay. I want miles, not ages. Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Miles are more fun.
That's true. It's Harrison Ford says that. The Raiders of the Lost Ark. It's the mileage, not the years.
Maybe that's where I got it. I know it's from somewhere. Maybe.
It's the mileage.
Yeah.
In the Indiana Jones. Yeah.
The other thing that I have to say about that is that I think of things in terms of a functional reserve. So we all have a bare minimum of what we need to be able to do in order to stay independent in our own homes. Okay? We have to be able to get out of bed. We have to be able to get to the bathroom. We have to be able to get food. Okay? With a bare minimum. All right? If you cannot do those things, you are in a home. Somebody else is taking care of you. Okay? All right. Now, if you are able to do just that, what happens if you get the flu and you're flat on your back for 3 days? Okay. Everybody has gotten the flu and gotten flat on their back for 3 days. I don't care if you're 8 years old. Right. I don't care if you're 8 years old, and I don't care if you're 98 years old. If you get the flu and you're flat on your back for 3 days, you are going to lose function. Because our body, if you don't use it, you lose it. The same with the brain, the same with the body. If you don't use it, you lose it. So if you are at that bare minimum right now, you're on the couch, you stop doing everything, you're at that bare minimum, and you say, God, Doc, I want to increase my activity levels. And he says, oh, you're getting older, you don't need to. You know what? Yes, I do. I need that functional reserve. I need that in case I get sick and I lose function, I still have the ability to do what I need to do. Okay, and not end up in a home, or not end up, not able to get out of bed and found 6 days later. Right? Mm-hmm. I mean, those are horrible, horrible things that happen to people, and that's what I would tell my doctor. I would say, well, Doc, I'm only able to do the bare minimum right now. I need to be able to get above that so that if I do get sick, I do get pneumonia, or I do, fall and twist my ankle, I can still do my bare minimum.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. That's very important.
Yeah.
But you just have, as far as gaining each day, you just kind of have to experiment and find that on your own, whether you need an extra half hour or hour of sleep and a little more.
It's a lot of trial and error. It is a lot of trial and error.
What makes you feel better, and we'll just kind of keep you.
It's been over 10 years and I'm still working on it.
I see. Let me know quickly.
But everybody is different. So, what I may need an entire Saturday where I stay in bed all day, somebody else may drop them back further. They may need to spend half a day on Saturday and half a day on Sunday in bed. Who knows? I don't know. But this is, you'd have to kind of figure it out on your own.
So just like real quickly, how do you break the cycle? Is there any how do you break the cycle of your brain telling your body that it can't do something? Like just, if you pick this up, your whole arm's going to hurt for 2 days. How do you break your brain to the cycle of when your body in actuality should be able to pick it up with no problem, but how do you break that cycle of
to train it? So if you're talking about, say, a gallon of milk, okay? Okay, that's 8 pounds. So you're going to work on lifting 1 pound and putting it up on the shelf. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you're going to do that.
Baby steps.
Yes, baby steps. You're going to do that until your brain figures out, well, that's not a big deal, so we're going to try 2 pounds. Okay? Or we're going to try, you know, and we're going to increase it. Same way you would if you wanted to enter a lifting contest and lift 300 pounds, deadlift. Okay, same way. It's just we're starting at a different, we're starting on the couch. We're not starting at, you know, I'm a relatively fit person in my 30s, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we're just starting it smaller.
I kind of did that with, I had a pinched nerve in the neck. I couldn't lift a gallon of milk out of the refrigerator. I mean, if I pulled it out, it went to the floor. And I thought, well, let's see. I can do it with this hand. But to start with, I would just go outside and throw a tennis ball.
Mm-hmm.
Usually I would throw it a long ways, but I could only throw it maybe from here to the corner of the room to the mm-hmm. dog. And
animals are great for...
Yeah.
That
the kind of keep you yeah, making yeah. one. Do yeah, more, they, do yeah. more, do more. So,
so
you know, and
they don't
and then,
stop.
Right, like, right. But that was kind of the level. We went from a gallon of milk to a tennis ball in just 10, 15 feet.
Okay.
And so, you know, and then you know, I initially could maybe only do 6 or 8 tennis balls, and his arm was just kind of almost limp. And you just work it up to 15, 20, and you think, what if I can lift the milk? Nope, still can't lift that gallon of milk out. So you just keep working and do, you know,
it's better.
Cans of beans, corn, whatever, off the shelf. And
I like to tell myself, I can't do something, or I cannot do something, but I ask myself, how can I do it?
Mm-hmm.
And then I figure it out from there.
Yeah.
I don't believe I can't do nothing. I just have to figure out how I got to do it.
How to do it.
Okay. Yeah. So there is, yeah, there's activity modification. There's slow things. If you have difficulty, there's always physical therapy to try to get you from that point, okay? Or a personal trainer or whatever. There's some good ones in the area that can work with people that have, you know, been really deconditioned. The last thing that I want to say, and then we need to end, but... the last thing I want to say is that a lot of this stuff, this guy, he cautions about using a lot of these techniques. He cautions about thinking of it in terms of getting rid of pain. He said, because that really actually won't happen right away. And by the time you're going to get tired of failing between now and when it actually does happen. Okay, so you have, yeah, exactly. So what he suggests is that you think about things like in terms of I'm working on making my brain healthier. Because this brain picture of this brain here, not a healthy brain. So you're working on making your brain healthier by doing the visualization, by doing the this or that, or, you know, and the same thing with the body. Is, you know, as you're doing a little bit more, as you're throwing the tennis ball, you're not trying to, you know, lift up the gallon of milk tomorrow. You're trying to make your arm healthier, your neck healthier, and able to withstand more. Okay, so change that expectation of, you know, oh, I'm going to cure my pain by doing this. No, I'm going to make my brain and my body healthier by doing this. The pain will subside from there. Okay, because pain is a signal that something's not right, right? And if everything is healthy and right, then pain has no need anymore, right?
Mm-hmm. Sometimes I'll do this thing where, like, I'll get a migraine. It doesn't happen often, like once every 3 months or something. And I imagine, like, right, you know, you just, like, right there. And I imagine, like, a glowing red, hot, you know, light just of pain. And then I'll kind of think of, like ice, or like kind of like mental ice kind of sitting on it, kind of, and it, like kind of being thrown at it. And it does help a little, it'll kind of take the edge off of the really hot, glaring pain.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll just think of like, you know, just ice, just ice pouring down over it like a waterfall. And it doesn't like super help, but it will take sort of the edge off. So the mental kind of, kind of just like mentally.
So there's at least one pain meditation that actually encourages you to do that, where you think of what does it look at? Does it have a shape? Is it, you know, what color is it?
Think of a ball of red hot horror.
And then take that, and see if you can, and he actually, scarily enough, asks you to try to make it worse. What does that look like when you make it worse? Okay, now let it go back down to where it was when you started. Like, oh, I kind of have control over that a little bit. I can, you know.
It's hard. I can't do it for long. It takes, because your brain's already crazy.
it's really hard to concentrate when you've got that much going on in your brain. All that area is lit up. I mean, it's really hard to concentrate.
Literally lit up.
And so it does, and then again, so that takes practice. It takes a lot of dedication, a lot of practice, and it certainly is like reading. It doesn't happen overnight. Next time we'll go over some more ways to do that, and kind of, I'll go over some of the support. You know, I would say yes, except that I have to have time to go through it.
I know, you're going to be all
I got it yesterday at noon, and I've been doing like this happy dance for the last 24 hours, but I only had like 15 minutes to actually look at it, so, anyway.
You're going to be all... full of stuff there.
I've been thinking about, I'm like, do you think my patient would notice if I'm rubbing his back and I just laid it out on his back and I'm reading? Probably they'd notice. Like, no, I probably shouldn't do that.
Try it and lay it out.
Try it. All right.
You can do it to me. You can lay it out.
As long as you get a background, you prepare.
That's right, yes.
All right. Any questions? That's a lot of stuff. That's a lot of information. Yeah. And it's different from how we were raised. So
it's hopeful, though. It gives hope.
Definitely. Should we bring these with us next time?
If you remember, I probably have something else for you next time. Just kind of a breakdown of what they are. And I mean, I'm obviously not going to reprint the whole book, but you know, I need
You're
to.
Not.
No, copyright laws, all that good stuff.
Oh, yeah. You can't buy copies.
Don't do that page.
You'll leave out one page and it'll
just
be fine.
Leave out
right?
one page.
All right. Awesome. Thanks for coming, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Oh, you know.